Jai Bhim, and welcome everyone to this public appeal meeting on the COVID emergency and India's incarcerated human rights defenders. We ask the question, are they jailed to die? The meeting is coordinated by INSAF India, International Solidarity for Academic Freedom in India. My name is Lotika Singha, and I'm an HRF at the University of Wolverhampton, UK. I'll be co-moderating this meeting with my INSAF India colleague, Simika Roth, an independent researcher with a PhD from University of Hyderabad and based in Switzerland. We, INSAF India, are a group of diasporic academics and citizens more generally, all with roots in India, who are concerned, upset, worried, and anxious about the increasing assaults on academic freedom in India, including attacks on anti-caste academics, artists and activists, trade unionists, lawyers and journalists. And today we will focus on the group of 16 who've become known as the Bhim Koregaon or BK16 and have been incarcerated under India's colonial sedition law, the Unlawful Activities Prevention Act or UAPA. Their arrests were premised on, as is now well established, planted evidence to an incident of violence at Bhima Koregaon on 1st January 2018, where every year Dalit communities gather to commemorate a historic victory. We consider it our obligation and our responsibility to raise our voices, to direct international attention to what is happening in India, because academic freedom is inextricably linked to social justice, and both knowledge production and formation are bound to the fostering of our social selves. Along with INSAF India, this webinar is co-hosted by India Civil Watch International, and we will have a Q&A session in the end. So please do post your questions in the Q&A box and not in the chat box. Thank you. I would like to now welcome and thank all our guests for being here today. We have three family members. Yes, Jenny has also joined. So we have three family members. We have Sagar Abraham Gonzalez, who's son of Vernon Gonzalez. We have Koyal Sen, a filmmaker and artist and daughter of Shoma Sen. We have Jenny Ruena, who's a lecturer at Delhi University and wife of Honey Babu. And we have also have Father Stan Swami's close associate from Bangalore, Father Joseph Xavier. Our two speakers today are Shahrukh Alam, a practicing lawyer at the Supreme Court of India, and Akar Patel, columnist and director of Amnesty International India. I will now hand over to Simi to invite Shahrukh to speak.
Thanks, Lotika. I'd like to welcome Shahrukh again to this event. We can start the conversation with a question to you. An emphasis on decongestion of prisons in the context of raging pandemic is quite evident in current legal discourse. But you may be interested to explore the cause of situation of congestion in prisons that precedes the violation of fundamental rights as well as legal rights of prisoners. The directive issued to the High Powered Committee by the Supreme Court of India to decongest the prisons by granting blanket bail for prisoners fulfilling certain criteria specifically excludes those arrested under UAPA and cases being investigated by the Central Bureau of Investigations, the Enforcement of Directorate or ED, the National Investigation Agencies. In this context, you may previously made the significant observation that exclusion of certain prisoners from the chance of blanket parole indicates the right to life and the right to health can be suspended by the state even in the face of raging pandemic. And that is, this is not only a violation of rights of life and health, but the violation of common law of duty of care. Can you elaborate on how it is a kind of constitutional violation itself, since it is a violation of fundamental rights and the duty of care that are provided in the Constitution? The second question, there is what, can you elaborate how this law of arrest and of criminal investigations and of procedures led to targeted arrest of certain communities or prisoners of conscience?
Sure. Thank you, Simi. Thank you for having me here. And before I start, I want to address the families and the friends of those who are in prison, prisoners of conscience. Whatever I have to say is black letter law. It's dry, it's theoretical, and it's also cynical. And it doesn't really touch upon your pain, the kind of pain that you are going through. But anyway, here's what I have to say. Simi, you asked me two questions, so I'll respond in two parts. And the first part, which is to do about violations of constitutional rights. Let's start with the question, why are Indian prisons so congested in the first place? I know we are overpopulated, but why do we have such numbers? Why are there so many under-trial prisoners in Indian prison? And there is a simple answer. All over the world, especially in common law jurisprudence, also in continental law jurisprudence, it's settled law that the arrest cannot be the starting point of an investigation. In fact, arrest should happen right at the end of the investigation when the investigators are ready with whatever evidence that they've collected. And right at the end, when they want to confront the accused with the evidence that they've collected, and when they are ready to press very specific charges. And by specific charges, I don't mean the arrest memos that are given to the accused and their family members here. I mean very precise accusations under law with respect to each act of omission or commission that the accused is supposed to have committed. So common law and also continental law recognizes a very specific duty of care towards the accused in conducting an investigation. And then after the investigation is conducted, the duty of care continues towards an expeditious trial. You can't let an accusation or an allegation hanging on the head of the accused. So as the state, as the investigator, you are supposed to quickly conduct an investigation and then quickly finish trial, quickly finish judging the accused. But in India, and again, quite apart from the fact that our system is overworked and under-resourced, even normatively, even in terms of black letter law, because of our particular colonial legacies, because our penal law and our procedural laws are products of colonial legacies, this duty to care has not been recognized. In India, any kind of encounter with the accused is seen by the state as an opportunity to establish its authority over truant subjects. So in India, an arrest is considered the start of an investigation. It's not the end of any investigation, it's the start of an investigation. So when a crime is committed, the police goes and picks up a few suspects and basically badgers them as the investigation proceeds. So in sheer numbers, where you could have had one person arrested as an accused for a crime, the police has picked up five, and all those five people are in prison being badgered as the investigation is processing, as the investigation is proceeding, and eventually only one will face trial because eventually only one would be made the accused. But instead of one person, we have five people being processed through the investigation. And also Indian law, black letter law, normatively, allows for 14 days of police custody, 14 days of police remand. So it's an acceptable notion in Indian law that investigators are free to torture, to beat up the accused in police custody, to get them to confess or get them to make some kind of concession. Custodial interrogation, which is now an acceptable part of Indian jurisprudence, and courts often allow remand to the police for the express purpose of custodial interrogation, which is only a euphemism for torture, is actually illegal in common law. Because common law recognizes that investigators cannot badger suspects or accused for information. It's their job. It's not the suspect's job to give it to them. I want to draw a comparison with with what goes down in certain jurisdictions in England or Scotland, for instance. And while doing this, I recognize that in theory, while things may sound very, very nice, perhaps in reality, it's not as nice as I'm describing it to be. But even then, for the purposes of a comparison, it's important to just see that in Scotland, for instance, law allows only 6 hours of detention of the accused. And in 6 hours, if you're not able to press charges, you have to let the accused go. In India, it's 90 days and 6 months. In Scotland, it's 6 hours. That is the kind of difference we are looking at. In 2014, Scotland had thought about increasing that period of detention. And a report was issued. It's called the Lord Carloway Report of 2014 on reforms in Scottish criminal procedure. And they completely rejected this idea. I'm quoting from the report. It says, "Our culture of investigation does not rely on badgering the suspect for information alone. It's best that there be brief timelines for questioning in detention." But after that, they've still made it 6 hours. And beyond 6 hours, if you want to detain the suspect or the accused longer, you need permission in writing, explaining why it's necessary to keep the accused for 12 hours. For terrorist offenses, they allow 12 extra hours. So that's 24 hours. At the end of those 24 hours, you have to press charges, specific charges, or let the accused go. Although they've increased the detention period to about 12 plus 12 hours, the same Carloway report says that 83% of the detentions in Scotland end within 6 hours. And the mean detention period for the accused is 4 hours. And less than 0.5% detainees exceed 12 hours. In terms of sheer numbers, that's 350 accused people were detained for more than 12 hours in all of 2014. And even when the accused is charged, the duty of care continues. So within 2 days of charging, they have to be produced for solemn proceedings before the magistrate, before the court, where you present, the prosecution has to present charges before the court. If remand continues, which means that if bail is not granted, then everything is fast-tracked. And if trial does not commence within 12 months, then she will not be tried at all. Then you have to let the accused go. You have to acknowledge that the investigators were not ready in time and the trial cannot happen. Similarly, in England, it's 24 hours plus 12 hours with the permission of a senior officer in writing. It's a total of 4 days in custody with the permission of the magistrate. And it's 14 days for terrorist offenses. Although I must admit that there is some confusion there. Some people have suggested that it's 28 days. My research shows it's 14 days for terrorist offenses. Some years ago, there was a bill brought to Parliament, the British Parliament, which sought to make the period of detention for terrorist offenses 90 days. But it was rejected in Parliament for being a travesty to human liberty and a perfidy in common law. The British Parliament rejected this proposal, saying you can't have 90 days of detention, even for terror accused, because it's a perfidy. It's a travesty in common law. In India, it's 6 months under the security laws. And it's 90 days, it's 3 months for serious offenses, even within the Indian Penal Code. So that is the kind of difference that we are looking at. That's the kind of discrepancy we are looking at. So obviously then, there are five prisoners, there are five under trials or more for every one suspect that there should have been. Section 1 of the Criminal Procedure Code, the Indian Criminal Procedure Code, says that you can arrest someone if there is reasonable belief that the person has committed an offense. Except reasonable belief is not defined. It's considered a private emotion of the investigator. It's never questioned. So all that the investigator has to do now is to stand up in court and say that grave conspiracy, or there's a real conspiracy, and I need time because I believe that something has happened. I don't know what it is, but I believe something has happened. And I need time to unearth it. And they're given time for the asking. They're given time up to 6 months for the asking. And last of all, with respect to congestion in prison, there are lots of people who are arrested for interrogation when really there's no need to interrogate. Even if you want to try them, even if you want to book them for something, the case is quite obvious. There was this dreadful case that happened in Tuticorin some last year, where two Dalit men, in fact, were arrested, brought to prison, brought to jail, beaten up all night, and one of them died the next day. Or both died. One died, I think. And the allegation was that they were both shopkeepers and they had kept their shop open beyond curfew hours during COVID times. Now, even if you want to try them, where is the need to arrest and interrogate? Because the investigating officer is himself claiming that he has it on CCTV that the shop was open. So then try them on the basis of that CCTV evidence. Where is the need to interrogate? And similarly, with journalists who are arrested, for instance, for seditious speech or for seditious writing, the writing is in front of you. Why do you want to arrest and investigate that person when the offending article is in front of you? Father Xavier is pointing out that both died in the Tuticorin incident. I stand corrected. So that's with respect to the first question, that there is this kind of congestion in our prisons for reasons that are based in our criminal investigation system, our criminal justice system. And now I want to address the second question that you asked me, which is about why are certain people targeted? Let me start with section 15 of the UAPA, which is our security legislation. It's called the Unlawful Activities Prevention Act. And section 15 basically says that if someone, with the help of bombs or firearms or lethal weapons or toxic gases or noxious substances, tries to disrupt life or tries to overawe the government, then they will be accused of terrorist activity. Now, as a lawyer, I ask myself, both in the Bhima Koregaon instance and in the arrests following the anti-CAA riots and the anti-CAA protests in Delhi, there's not even an accusation that the accused had any of these substances. There were no firearms, there were no bombs, there were no toxic gases, none of that. So how is it that whatever it is that they've done, basically protests, how is it that it constitutes a terrorist activity as described under the Act? But to answer that question, we must read the Bhima Koregaon FIR and also the anti-CAA protest FIR. The FIR 4 of 2018, which was registered after the event that happened in Shanivar Wada in Pune, organized by the Elgar Parishad, says that they were very provocative performances delivered from the stage. So the FIR is saying that you were delivering provocative performances with a view to misguide and mobilize the depressed classes. That is the primary offense against you. And similarly, the anti-CAA FIR of Delhi, FIR 59 of 2020, says that the accused tried to further the propaganda that minorities are oppressed in India, and they tried to mobilize people to that effect. So both FIRs describe a situation where some people are accused of having tried to further a political articulation and to mobilize people around that political articulation. It's very unusual for FIRs to announce or to declare that a political articulation is an offense, but this is what both these FIRs have done. And in doing that, these FIRs are basically trying to draw the permissible limit of civic participation. They are saying that if you are overtly hostile to the government, then you can't do that. You cannot overtly and vocally wish for political change in India. And if you want to organize a protest, then you'd better have a working relationship with the majoritarian sentiments in India. If your political articulation does not fall within the majoritarian popular sentiment, then don't organize protests. And if you organize protests outside of these permissible limits, then basically you're outside the political in the Agambenian sense. Then you're in a state of exception. Then you fend for yourself. And further, both the Bhima Koregaon charge sheet and the anti-CAA charge sheet say that it's also a problem when a certain kind of people collect together to articulate a political concern. In the anti-CAA protest, which is the prosecution's case is recorded in the judgment that's just come out, and I'll refer to that judgment in a bit, but the prosecution case says very categorically against the accused that the charge against them is that they visited Muslim majority areas and campaigned as part of the project and campaigned as part of the protest and coordinated with local imams in mosques to mobilize Muslims for the protest. This is described as a terrorist activity. To be actively mobilizing only Muslims to articulate a political concern is described as a terrorist activity. So basically, both these charge sheets are also implying that the kind of people that were mobilized for the protests were suspicious subjects. They were people who fall outside the accepted political. They're people who, in the Agambenian sense again, people who are in a state of exception. And these are people who are very easily swayed. These are people who get very easily agitated and very easily violent. So therefore, the accused, by mobilizing such people, were doing something that was inherently a dangerous activity, that was inherently a terrorist activity. And in two places, at least in the judgment, the prosecution keeps referring to the Muslim protesters as mobs without attributing any kind of violence to them. Just the fact that they were together and protesting is sufficient to describe them as mobs. And that makes me think that what the prosecution case does, both in Bhima Koregaon and in Delhi, is that it normalizes the perception that certain people, Muslims, Dalits, Adivasis, their mere presence, their bare bodies are like lethal weapons. Their bare bodies are noxious substances of Section 15 UAPA. So the fact that you're together, you're collecting, your bare bodies are collecting and occupying a public space amounts to a terrorist activity because you are noxious. And then therefore it is so easy now for the Supreme Court and its guidelines to exclude these bare bodies and say that their right to life, their right to health is suspended. Everyone else will get the benefit of the interim orders during COVID. They will not, because there are bare bodies. And then following from there, the high level committees of different states, and I'm talking of Delhi specifically here, go a step further, and they also exclude people who have not just been charge sheeted, but who are merely being investigated. So who are people who are at the pre-charge stage, who have not been charged, who are just being investigated. Even they have been excluded from the benefit of the blanket orders. They will not be given interim bails during COVID times. They will remain in congested prisons because, again, they are bare bodies. One last point. What both these cases do, the Bhima Koregaon case and also the Delhi case, is that they also normalize retaliatory violence. They say that, of course, there would be retaliatory violence if these people gather together, because these people are suspicious subjects, because these people fall outside of the political. So when these people gather, other people, the rightful citizens, get terrorized and they retaliate. And that violence is normal. It should have been expected. And they say that in the context of Delhi, and they say that in the context of Bhima Koregaon, thus inverting completely the relationship between the perpetrator and the victim. The victim in both cases become the first violators. Why did you gather? And because you gathered, there was violence. So I'll end there. Just one last thing. This particular logic of the state has been dispelled for now by the beautiful judgment of the Delhi High Court in the context of the anti-CA protest, the Delhi cases. The court has said that this is rubbish. Nobody is outside the political space. Even if you're loudly criticizing the government, even if you are being unruly, you are not terrorists. You are still subjects. You are still citizens of the state. So this logic was dispelled, but unfortunately the state went and appealed to the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court has admitted their appeal for now. It's not been decided, but it will be examined. And in the interim, the Delhi High Court judgment has been stayed in a way. The logic of it has been stayed in a way. Thank you.
Thanks, Shahrukh, for your brilliant observation that really helpful to reveal the blind spots in our current legal discourse. I hand over this session to Lodhiga to invite family members for the session of testimonies.
Thank you, Shahrukh, and thank you, Simi. Sagar, Koyal, Jenny, and Jenny has some connectivity issues, but she'll be getting back, and Father Xavier. We know it isn't easy, but the world needs to hear you're from your side. And I know you've been talking in India as well, but we do need, you're trying to take your, if your voice can reach out further. And what you're going through and what you are sort of have been going through for so long with a family member or a colleague in prison at this time without a trial in sight, as we know. So I'd like to invite Sagar to start by sharing your thoughts, Sagar.
Hello, can am I audible? So how long can I speak for? Because I had a couple of points.
So we've given the four of you, hopefully we'll have 35 minutes. So
okay.
For all of you. So if you can.
Okay. So, thank you very much, firstly, to INSAF for giving us this platform. I think it's very important that people hear about this case because as Shahrukh pointed out, it's a grave injustice that is happening in our country today. So as a family member, as a person who's been closely involved with this case for the past, my father has been, he was arrested in August 2018 and he's been in prison for three years almost now without a trial. So for me, my personal experience, I will sort of share it in a couple of points. First being like personally how it impacts me and then on a little of a broader level. So one point, I had thought of it in four points. First point being the physical absence of a person and how do you feel that and how do you process that? Somebody who you live with and you spend 24/7, you spend your time with. So my father was at home, he was working from home. And then all of a sudden this case happens and he's taken away from you. And then it's a huge void that it's very difficult for you to understand how to fill. And like a person like my father is, he had a very infectious personality. So his presence is surely missed. So it's just very difficult. Like the most difficult, I guess, is just the physical absence of someone who you love and cherish and who you spend so much time with. How do you just deal with that is just very hard to take. And this transcends to other family relationships also, like with my grandmother. He was very fond of my grandmother and used to take care of her very well. And sadly, my grandmother passed away a month ago and he wasn't even able to attend a funeral or like a video conference where he could see her. And for 3 years, basically, he was denied access to his mother, someone who I have seen him taking care of. And I mean, it's someone who he was extremely fond of. And so it's just, it's so heartbreaking to think of how actual relationship is just, you couldn't even be with the person in their last days. And you couldn't even see the person as they were being, as she was, and during her funeral, he wasn't, he himself said that he didn't want to be a part of it because he knew how much of an effort it is. It's not easy to get permission to be part of a funeral. So he didn't want to put us through that. So he said, just let it be, it's fine. So that was the physical aspect is one thing. Another thing I feel is the communication channel that has been severely affected by this COVID pandemic. And it's been so horribly impacted because earlier we used to get to meet them in court and we used to get to visit them in jail at least. But what has happened with the pandemic is that court visits have been stopped and jail visits also have been stopped. So initially, it was very difficult. Like the last year was very, because there was no, for months on end, there was no calls from them. We weren't getting any phone calls. And then the lawyers had to time and time again file petitions in the court just to allow phone calls to happen. Then I remember after 2 months or so, the phone calls started coming in. But initially, they were for 2 minutes. And 2 minutes, when you talk to a person after 10 days or a month, and you get only 2 minutes to speak to them, and there's my mother and me both having to speak. And how much can you speak to a person in 2 minutes when you haven't spoken to them for months on end? So those 2 minutes used to just go away like that. Like, it was really, I mean, you could barely say anything. So I would generally just allow my mother to speak because she's a lawyer and she had legal things to discuss also. So the communication channel was horribly, and we give petitions again to the jail in court and just be like, can we just speak for a longer time? But that was just not allowed. Then jail visits were allowed briefly when the lockdown sort of opened, but now again they've been shut. And so now again, the communication, now we're getting longer calls after a year, and we get like 10 minute calls, and even 10 minutes is not a lot. But then when you were getting a minute earlier, 10 minutes just seems like a big deal. And in the middle, what happened is letters, which were one constant source of communication, that was sort of halted because the superintendent in Taloja jail, where all the male under trials are in the Bhima Koregaon case, he seemed to have a sort of enmity with them for some reason. So the letters had been coming very slowly. Like, my father would write a letter and it would come 2 months late. So we were in a limbo kind of situation where we didn't know. There was just no communication. And this was in the middle of a pandemic where time and time again, we were being told that people over the age of 60 are the most prone to catching the virus. And my father is above 60. Most of the people in the Bhima Koregaon case are above 60. And many of them have comorbidity. So how do you communicate with someone who, I mean, if there's no, how do you know if the person is fine or not? And you were hearing news about outbreaks in prison, and then in that kind of a time you can't speak to the person, just like basic communication is not allowed. So that was very stressful. Like, particularly in last year when Varvara Rao caught COVID, my father was taking care of him in the jail prison. So there were these 2-3 weeks where we didn't know whether my father was tested or not. So I remember those calls were very harrowing with the prison staff, where we would call them and ask them if he had been tested or not. And then they would tell us, no, you call this number. And somebody else would tell us, you call that number. And it was, you would want to get enraged at that point, but there's no point getting enraged because you're at their mercy. So even if you get angry and yell at them, there's no point. They're the ones who, it's all in their hands. So you really can't get enraged. So all you have to do is beg, and like, not beg, but just ask very politely, even though the situation is so frustrating. And it was a very demeaning experience. Thankfully, nothing happened to my father and he was fine and he didn't catch the virus. But that was a very anxious period for us as a family, where for like, it was just like a complete communication blackout. So I think these were the things that physically manifested it. Then on a broader level, for me, it's just been this, the whole injustice of this situation is just so difficult to process, because it's injustice at so many levels. You have the state acting so cruelly and viciously, you have the judiciary from the Sessions Court to the High Court to even the Supreme Court who are denying bail time and time again just because of UAPA. Like, in, not in my dad's case in particular, but in other people's case, like say for Varavara Rao, who's above 80, when bail was asked for him, bail was denied citing UAPA, saying that because of UAPA and so prima facie, there is a case, hence he cannot be denied bail. And like he caught COVID and his health was in such a bad condition that he was almost on his deathbed. So it's just the injustice of the situation where a person had to almost, and now he's out on bail, but the fact that he was almost on his deathbed and he almost had to die for the courts to finally come and take notice that, maybe this person deserves bail. Let's give him bail. It's so mind boggling to wrap your head around that. Like, how can you be so unjust, and how can this, and now after Varavara Rao also so many people like Professor Hani Babu has that horrible eye infection, Father Stan Swami, who's 84 years old, he's also horribly unwell, and you're just so worried about what are you waiting for? Do you want another Varavara Rao like situation? And I think the title of the event is very aptly named, that dying in prison. So what are we waiting for, these people to die? I mean, it's very difficult to process. And after the fact that the evidence came out, that the Arsenal report came out citing that the evidence is planted, the state, rather than being self-introspective about their own case and maybe saying that, maybe we committed a mistake or something like that, they're doubling down. They're saying, no, this is wrong. This is not true at all. And we did everything. And no, we will not accept it. This is not acceptable. And they're saying things like this is being done to delay the trial when they themselves have not done nothing to start the trial for the past 3 years. And they just ask for more time to increase the evidence. So the injustice of it, and then to at the end of it, I think just the hate that has been generated by a very lapdog sort of media that exists sadly in our country today, that is not doing the job that journalists are meant to do. They just parrot the narrative that the state's put into their mouth. So if the state is saying that these people are terrorists, you have the media, like the TV media and print, to some extent, who will say that, yes, they are terrorists. They were planning on assassinating the PM. And it's great that they've been arrested. It was a big plot that was nipped in the bud. If this plot was not nipped in the bud, all of these people would have overthrown democracy and the PM would have been assassinated and whatnot. Rather than questioning what is the evidence, how true is your evidence, they just parroted the state's narrative, and then from the media, it caught on in social media. And what media says, the social media just hypes it up 10x. And at present, the social media in India is extremely vicious, where you have a troll army just waiting to heap hate and anyone who's just questioning of the state authority. So then they were calling for execution. And then when you hear of these things of execution for people we know, for people we're close to, our family members, that they shouldn't even be given a trial, they should be executed straight off because they're anti-national and they're urban Naxals and they're enemies of the state. So then, I mean, you're just like, why do you hate a person who you know nothing about? Like, you know, you're believing a narrative that has been thrown to you and you're just vomiting it out. So that also affects you really psychologically sometimes. Thankfully, there's been a lot of support and solidarity which we've been constantly receiving. So that helps to manage all of this. But yeah, this has been my experience so far. Luckily, my father is... his health has been, touch wood, has been not too bad, but it's like a ticking time bomb, really. Like, anything can happen. Those prisons are so congested. He's in a barrack with 40 other people. Anything can happen. And it just seems like they're waiting for something really horrible to happen before they actually do anything. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Sagar, so much for sharing these thoughts and, yeah, what can I say? I'm just so sorry. Koyal, yeah, can I ask you to speak now?
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Lotika, Simi, and thank you for having this event and having us. And Sagar has put actually very aptly most of the things that we as family members are going through. And yes, it is an experience which is, which is very hard to describe. You only understand it when once you experience someone very close to you being put behind bars. It's a mix of helplessness. It's a mix of frustration. It's a mix of what you want to, but you cannot do anything. And it takes a toll on the family members in various ways. And we are anxious most of the time, worried about their health. So out of the 16 Bhima Koregaon under trials who are right now in Indian prisons, especially in Maharashtra, there are three women prisoners. One of them is my mother, Shoma Sen. Then there's Sudha Bharadwaj and Jyoti Jagtap, who are the women prisoners who are in the Baikala Women's Jail, which is geographically very far from the other jail where most of the male under trials have been placed, which is in another area in Mumbai itself called Taloja Jail. Now, the amenities and the facilities in the two jails are starkly different. Surprisingly, Baikala Jail being in South Bombay, also being in a slightly more central area of Bombay, has a lot of facilities in place. But the men's jail, where most of the males members are in Taloja Jail, are facing a lot of problems, right from basic water shortage to lack of proper healthcare. I've been told that there are three Ayurvedic doctors in Taloja Jail, and not even a proper professional medical care is being given to many of the under trials there. And so I'll talk more about, I think others can speak about Taloja Jail, because my mom is in Baikala, which is the women's jail, and I have close contact with her. So again, she is thankfully doing, she's all right. She's not in a very great shape. She's 63 years old and she has glaucoma, she has arthritis. The situation where she is, the condition where she, the way they have been kept in the Indian prisons in Mumbai, in Baikala, is that they are around 40 women, senior citizen women, who have been put inside one barrack. And the other day I was having a phone conversation with my mom, and she told me that, I just wanted to know how much of a distance is there between two women who are next to each other. She said it's literally 6 inches. So at night, if you're taking a turn, you might just put your hand on another person. So that is the congestion. That is how closely they are being kept in a small barrack, 40 women, in a situation that is so worrisome today with COVID pandemic. And we know how badly India has been hit in the second wave. So every day we are worried. Every day we are wondering how they are and what's happening. And of course, the entire case is, it's just, it just feels it's so unjust. You know, it's right from the beginning. For instance, the very evidence that we are talking about now, from day one, most of us who've seen the letter that they claim to be, you know, a part of the plot to assassinate the PM, is so shoddily written. It's so from the beginning one can tell that this is fake. It is so simple for any layman to just say that it's fake. And after 3 years of my mom spending time in prison, we finally managed to get a US-based agency called Arsenal Consulting that has come up with a proper analysis of hard disks and data from all the accused, 16 accused. And we have been able to find out that one of the accused, called Rona Wilson's laptop, was hacked through a malware in 2017. And these incriminating documents were planted in his computer. So even now, just yesterday, there was a listing of one of the petitions that we filed in the name of Rona Wilson and my mother, Shoma Sen, stating that the entire case must be quashed. The entire case is based on wrongful and fraudulent evidence. And there has the Bombay High Court, it was yesterday was a listing at the Bombay High Court where it was argued. And we also got a reply from the central agency saying completely denying any of the they are not even accepting that our Senil Consulting is a valid agency for a valid organization. For instance, they are talking about things like this should have been brought up during the trial, but then they are the ones who are delaying the trial in the first place. And so now again, there has been a demand of 2 weeks by the state to further their response in this ongoing case, which is the case of the fraudulent the planting of the evidence. And again, there'll be almost like a month's delay, and then there'll be a response, and there'll be again something that will, you know, be mentioned. So I mean, just to bring it in context, like the way Shahrukh also gave a perspective of what how the criminal system, justice system works in India, the main thing that's really happening is what the state is getting is that they are just being able to keep these people behind bars. The entire thing is around keeping them in jails for as long as they can. And in this whole process, they are getting support from the judges, they're getting support from, you know, the NIA. They're just being able to therefore extend the stay, and this the process is becoming the punishment. I mean, we can't even think of starting, like, I don't even know when the trial is going to begin. And it's been 3 years since my mom has been in jail. So yeah, it is a very, very, very frustrating situation. We are all going through a lot of stress, and it's extremely unjust for a person like my mother, who's a PhD, who has been an academic for 38 years of her life, and her get dedicated her life's work to the upliftment of Dalit and Adivasi women in Maharashtra, and she is behind bars for 3 years. Yeah, thank you.
I'm so sorry again. Yes, indeed. Why is she there? We know, and like you said, Jenny, can I pass over to you? I just want to speak very minimal in between, because I really want you to get on with the time. So Jenny, are you there?
Yeah, I can speak.
Yes, please.
Shall I start?
Yes, please.
Okay. So what I wanted to say, first of all, is that I'll just continue with what Shahrukh was saying. I think the congestion, we have to see the congestion in the prisons in two ways. One is that the prisons are, many studies have shown that 70% under trials are there in prisons. I don't think this happens anywhere in the world, where you fill your prisons with under trials and who remain there for long years. Like from the letters that Babu write, we understand there are people in the jail who are like been there for 10 years. Recently, there was this Nanded case of ATS Maharashtra, where people, a Muslim man, Irfan, he remained in the prison for almost 9 years. As an under trial, and then he has been acquitted. So he has spent 9 years, and then now he has been found not to be guilty. So who will compensate for these 9 years? So what is really happening, this congestion that is happening, is due to this overload of under trials and some of the issues that Shahrukh has explained. And second thing that we have to understand is, who are these under trials, or who are these prisoners? 90% of them are from marginalized communities, SC, ST, OBC, and Muslims. And if you go to the prison, I had only one chance to visit Babu in prison. And even as I was standing there in the queue, we had to stand in the hot sun for almost 8 hours before we were called in. There is no waiting shed. There is no provision for the families also. You can understand that this system was made to dumb marginalized communities, to scare them, to not make them say anything against the state, and to like hold as a rod over their heads that if you do any kind of resistance, if you ask for more wages, or if you ask for any kind of reform or change, this will be your situation. You will be just thrown behind bars. False fabricated cases will be put over you, and you will have to lie there. And the people who really commit crimes, they are not the people who are behind bars. This is another thing that we have to see. Whether it is in the anti-NRC, the CA-NRC case or in the Bhima Koregaon case, we have to keep on remembering that a terrorist activity has happened. It is not that some people have been fabricated as terrorists. Terrorist activities have happened. I live in Delhi. I have visited Northeast Delhi. I saw houses burned. Okay, the whole house, a person who had a business of 21 crores in a year, his whole entire savings and house was burned, and people threw bombs and people burned down those houses. People came in buses and literally, you know, and the Hindu houses were not touched. There were these specific houses were burned. In the same way, in Bhima Koregaon, so many, almost 250 Dalit Bahujan organization and Muslim organization came together under one platform to celebrate the Bhima Koregaon event. And there was a riot that was unleashed by Hindutva forces. So, and one person died, a Dalit man died in this. There is an FIR nut, and some Hindutva people have been blamed also. So a crime has happened. Terrorist activities have happened in this case. Instead of actually investigating those people, catching those people and punishing them so that other such terrorist activities do not happen, so that Dalits and Muslims and OBCs can live in this country with some kind of security. Instead of doing that, you are catching people who speak for them, who work for them, who have been raising their voices, and in whichever sphere of activity they are, all the people you see in the Bhima Koregaon case or in the Delhi violence case, who are the people who were arrested? Look at the Hathras case where journalists were arrested. All of these people were talking against this kind of violence that is the continuous reality of Indian society. This is India is a caste colony, and jails are meant to manage this caste colony. It is made in such a way that is why it is congested. That is why it doesn't have water. That is why it doesn't have space for people to go. No Brahmin is going in the jail. You go and see in the jail. You don't have Brahmins there. If you had at least 25% population of Brahmins and upper caste, jails will immediately start having all sorts of facilities. It is because our people are in jails that we are not given any kind of facilities, and they don't care what happens to them. Once you're behind bars, people are routinely beaten up. All sorts of old, you know, very, very ancient practices as going on as modern, you know, phenomena. And what in the case of my husband is an OBC Muslim. He's coming from a community which is very underrepresented in academics. He's one of those few people who have come up with Mandal Commission. After the Mandal Commission, he has come up through reservation into the academy. And what happens once we come into the Indian university, which is again a very Brahminical sphere, jails are full of marginalized people and universities are full of upper caste Savarna. And in this kind of a situation, what happens is that most people who come in through reservations, they just keep quiet, or they just go along and they try to hide their identity and do not show their difference. That's the only way you can survive. My husband was somebody who did not choose that easy path. Instead of that, he made the first OBC organization in Delhi University called Academic Forum for Social Justice. He fought for the implementation of OBC reservations. Before the fight that this organization put up, there were no OBCs in the classrooms. I am also teaching in Delhi University. I've seen the classrooms. There were nobody. Now, after Mandal Commission, everything changed. And even then, Delhi University and many central universities refused to implement the OBC Reservation Act. So my husband is one of those people among the SCST OBC communities who have fought for that and seen to it with so many struggles, agitations, going to the parliament, meeting politicians, you know, right, doing RTI, and seen to it that reservations are implemented. This is the crime that he has committed. This is why he has been punished. Instead of celebrating such a person, you are throwing him into jail. That is because this is a caste colony. This caste colony can survive only by throwing such people who resist and question. And that is why the prisons are congested. And about this targeting, what you have to see is that this is, see, targeting of Dalit Bahujans have been, is part of Indian modernity. We have to understand that. This is not something that happened today or yesterday. And if you look at our media, you can understand, you look at the films. Every film will show a policeman beating up somebody brutally and nobody has anything, nobody feels anything. Completely normal. Completely normal to beat up. That is why we have one custodial death every day in India. No one will ask. The thing is, there is no accountability. To have accountability, you have to have freedom from the caste colony. If the institutions around you are completely not in support of you, and these institutions are completely Brahminical, how will you have accountability? You will go to a judge, you will go to an officer who is not going to support your community or the marginalized. And there will not be accountability. No one will be punished. Even if people die in jail, even if people have custodial death, nothing will happen. Even if you put 9 years. Now I talked about this case where Irfan was put in jail for 9 years. I just heard from the papers. Will anyone be punished for it? Will he be given compensation for it? It won't. That is not going to happen. And because of that, this will continue. And this will continue as long as we, you know, don't stop this colonization. And as long as Dalit Bahujans do not come to the power and, you know, and take over all these institutions and have an India which will give us something in return for the taxes we pay and for our, for our existence here. As long as that doesn't happen, I think this will continue. And I also want to say about my husband, not only that, you know, he was taken away from us for nothing. What has he done? Some documents have been found in his computer. These documents he has not even opened. They are just in a secret folder, it seems. And they prove that he is a Maoist. You ask him about, you know, it's a joke, okay? We are not even people who are connected to the left. And then you call us Maoists and you say, and what is the proof? My husband become a Maoist? What is the proof for that? And what did he do as a Maoist? What is the crime that he has done? And how can you just fabricate a case and just throw a person into jail? And after taking somebody like this, who has had a full, excellent, socially viable, an important life outside in society, you take such a person, throw him into jail, and then when he is sick, you don't even give him proper care. My husband almost died, you know. He had an eye infection which was so serious that it affected his vision. Now it has been, I think he got the eye infection on 3rd May. Now it is almost June middle. Till now his optic nerve has not healed. That is because they allowed the infection to grow so badly. Then we come to know that people just die off in jail. People just die of COVID, die of this, die of that. And no one asks these questions to them. And you go and look at who these people are. None of them big people, none of them people with connection, many of them from the poorest families. This is the state of our country. And we all need to understand this and do something against this. This is all I want to say.
Thank you, Jenny. Thank you so much for adding to what we'd already heard from Sagar and Koyal and everything. So I'm going to pass on to Father Xavier now, because you've talked of coming from to serious infections and people dying in jails. And we know what a concern it has been for us, for Stan Swami. So Father Xavier, could you unmute yourself? And
thank you. I think, thank you so much. The real pains, sufferings of family members, though I'm distantly, in a way, closely related to Stan Swami. Thank you for this opportunity. I think the world should hear this. To briefly put it, since many things have been covered, I'm going to cover maybe in different thoughts together. I will start from here. A few days ago in the High Court, Stan Swami said that I have been in Taloja more than 8 months. Number of my body parts have become weakened. I don't know what's happening to me. Even now, he is in ICU. Even when the latest medical report was submitted to the High Court, it was from ICU. What are we still looking for in terms of granting a bail? Procedural justice, fear of the central government, fear of NAA, still UAPA, 84 years. What are we still looking for? I can also say, last week, his pulse rate went up to 170. Doctors rushed him to ICU. They didn't know what was happening. What is the state waiting for? That he has to die? And he was ready for that. All that he wanted was, take me to Ranchi, I will die there, or allow me to die in Taloja. Because what else I can ask? This is the scenario. And it has been extended. It's concerned, okay, another 2 weeks, 3 weeks. How far in a helpless, vulnerable situation I have to go on living? Given his age, he had COVID positive, he's recovered. Probably the peak of the COVID was in Taloja itself. For whatever power, friends, Bhima Buregaon Jay's friends, Arun, Anand were there to help him, motivate him, support him. He was slowly getting out of it. When he came to hospital, he was tested positive. With the treatment, he has recovered. We know what has happened. Even then, we are not willing to listen to him. Now, going back to this, how do I understand his life and his suffering there? On 8th of October, when NAA approached the Bagaicha Center where he was living, all that they said is, we are taking you for a questioning. If you answer those 5-6 questions, you can come back. That's what they took in. He just went unprepared. Though intuitively he thought he may be arrested, he went unprepared. After going there, they were taking for a ride. Stan was continuously asking, where is that officer whom I should meet? He will come. Okay, evening 8:30, they take him. 9:30, 10:30, he said, and they gave him food. I'm not going to eat. You brought me to this NAA office in Ranchi to meet an officer. Show me the officer, I'll talk to him. Whatever questions he has, I'm going to answer, then leave me. No, we are not going to love you. Tomorrow he'll come. Tomorrow morning, 7 o'clock, they wake him up, get ready and eat. I'm not going to eat. I have to meet first what you promised to me, that I have to meet an officer. They said, no. Then 8:30, they're saying, get up, you have to go to the airport. What are you afraid of? Tell the old man, you are arrested, we are taking you. That even they didn't have the courage to tell him. They told others, but not him. Why are you taking me? Where are you? We are taking you to airport. Where? To Mumbai. Why? The officer will meet there. Even after getting down in Mumbai, without any knowledge he was taken, is this the way you treat a person? There, where is the officer? You will see him in the court. He goes to the court. Where is the officer? The officer comes. Now I will not meet, the judge will meet you. You see the beginning of the story, how a person is treated with. All that he has done is to really appreciate the Constitution, to live by the Constitution. Nothing else. All that he was asking throughout his life, how the constitutional provisions have been violated by various governments. That's all he's concerned about. We went, Shah Rukh was talking about the political articulation. I'm making it more concrete. It's a Dalit articulation. It's an Adivasi articulation. It's a minority articulation they were speaking. Demanding that Panchayat Raj Extension Act, which gives powers to Adivasis, must be implemented. Demanding the Adivasis' lands cannot be taken away, just like you treat any objects. This is what he was questioning. And he was asking why so many indigenous communities, the Adivasi youth, are put behind bars in the name of Maoists. What he has been questioning, the state turned out and said, you are the Maoists. If anybody can go to his place, how he lives, what he was, nothing of that, whether property, personal, because we belong to a Jesuit order. All that he was trained is to question, raise question on the unjust structures. And he did it not only with the state, with the Society of Jesus, with the caste structure, everywhere, church structure, government structure. He continued to ask why these poor have to pay the price for all these things. Don't they have the right to live with dignity? This has been the question. I'm going to contrast this with another example. Sam Sami was incarcerated in not only Bhima Prayang case, there was another case that was going on, which is called Patal Gadi case. Even in the Bagicha Center, there's a big stone there where the constitutional provisions are written, which was also spread out in various parts of the Adivasi villages. The constitutional provisions were written that was empowering the Adivasis. What is this? Oh, we have all these rights. We should demand the state. This was the movement that was going on. He was also not a very active member, but sympathizer of the rights of Adivasis, for which there was some sort of violence, and he was not even part of it. The numberless, countless people were in the FIR. Finally, the state government boiled down to 20. He was 16th member. Later, he was pushed to first member. He was about to be arrested. All this natak was going on, drama was going on till 2019. Till then, you have the BJP government. Then you have a new government being formed. Hemant Soren has to come to power. Till then, the state was calling him as anti-national. Hemant Soren comes, a political power change says, no, that Patal Gadi movement was not an anti-national movement. It's a pro-Adivasi movement. And we are withdrawing that case. How do you explain one state government saying another state government completely taking an opposite view of this? It's simply, if Stan would have belonged to a BJP party or a Congress party, they would have had enough immunity power even to do any sort of thing. Now, because you become a citizen of this country, articulating the concerns of the marginalized communities, you are called anti-national. This is one part of the story. In the jail, already Sagar has mentioned, this has been one of the biggest issues, the communication has been. He has been so faithful, even the prisoners, if you ask, he will call me, because we were only two contact persons, because Stan doesn't have a family in that sense. Me and one of another, my Jesuit companion, very often he would call me. He would be so faithful. He will call, we try to speak, and you know, he was hard of hearing, apart from Parkinson's. One earphone got, hearing aid got broken. He gave it for repair. It took such a long time to come. With little bit hearing, I have to shout. He will shout. And we don't even, within 3-4 minutes, Joe, my time is coming to an end. The only thing was a letter communication. With great difficulty, he will scribble some poem. And imagine what he was writing. In Taloja, humanity is bubbling. And caged bird can still sing. He was giving message of hope. And all that, what we want to say, the solidarity of these 16 families. And he was also concerned about other prisoners. He has told me, I need some clothes to help another prisoner. I know there is another prisoner close to me. He doesn't even know for which case he is there. He's more than me in this prison. We have to help them. These are sensitive citizens of this country who have imbibed the constitutional power. The government does not recognize, but he calls them anti-nationals. Now, 8 months are over. Now, still, what are we looking for? I can only imagine, Stan, what he's looking for is nothing else. That he wants to be back in Ranchi, and maybe that may be his last days. That's what it is. All that he wants is to speak to some of his old friends who are no more now due to age or COVID pandemic. It has been very difficult to communicate to me the death news, because he breaks down easily. Not for others, but some of his close friends. Last time, one of the calls, when I said, this person passed away, Joe, I cannot speak anymore. Please, let's close the call. Can't you give them that satisfaction of calling some people, talking to some people, expressing their solidarity at this age? What are you still looking for? They are going to be Maoists. And what evidence? Even 2 days ago, on 16th, for the bail petition we have filed, NA has come out with a big charge sheet saying, no, we can prove. Where can you prove? Start the trial. Don't delay the trial. Start the trial and prove what you are saying is right. There's no point in endlessly keeping them under prison with uncertainties, vulnerabilities, helplessness. If you're a professional agency, do what you are supposed to do. Don't go around and create myths and stories around these citizens who have really were supposed, what the government is supposed to do, these persons have done it. And you respect them. You may not recognize them, you avoid them, respect them, give them basic dignity of life, freedom to these people, respect what they have contributed to this country. That's the big service we can do. Don't do disservice to these people. Anyway, we understand we are in a structurally imbalanced system of majoritarian, minoritarian. We understand we have to go through this, but we are not giving up hope. This is the solidarity support we are expecting from all of you to expose this state, which lives with so much often contradictions, so much often inequalities of power, who enjoy this time to question and challenge. These persons' lives, memories, works should sort of give us energy and strength to pass on this legacy to our future generations. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Father Xavier. Thank you for reminding us again about our need to talk more and, like you said, not show solidarity and also spread the information about what is going on. So now I will hand over to Simi to invite Akar to speak.
Now we are going back to the session of conversation. I would like to invite Akar for conversation. Welcome, Akar. Thanks for joining with us today. We have a couple of questions to you. My first question is that, how do we respond to the issue that the family members and colleagues of Bimak or our own prisoners are telling us about? Why are the BK system so problematic for the Indian state? I come to the second question. As you mentioned elsewhere, violation of freedom of expression and freedom of speech and freedom of religion, etc., has been already happening in India in the recent past. But the current situation of raging pandemic quite delimits the question of life. It reduces the life to bare life within a situation that is already preconditioned to violation of such freedoms. It also suspends the value of qualified life from the idea of life of a person in general and of a person in particular. So how do you look at this issue from a human rights perspective? Does this question about the concept of life already pose a problematic for the very idea of human rights itself?
I think we are dealing with two things in the India of 2021. The first is there is an overarching majoritarianism that is being thrust on us by the government and the state for the first time in our history. It's nobody's case that India was anywhere close to being perfect before 2014. But post Mr. Modi's coming to power, what we have seen is the use of the constitution and the loopholes within it to try and insert an ideology called Hindutva, which basically stands for the brutalization and the marginalization of minorities further. By its own definition, this is what one of its ideologues said in 1965. That what they want is the political defeat of Muslims. That's part one. Second is the active brutalization through law of all minorities. They have actually achieved part one. If you look at the parliament in India of 2014, in Lok Sabha, you've got 282 Lok Sabha MPs, of whom none is a Muslim. And the parliament of 2019, you've got 303 Lok Sabha MPs, of whom none is a non-Muslim. So the marginalization is actually achieved of India's 28 states today. There is no Muslim chief minister in 15 states. There is no Muslim minister at all. In 10 states, there is one Muslim minister, normally given the portfolio of a minority affairs. In UP, which is our largest state, even a minority affairs has been given to a non-Muslim who looks after Waqf. So that's part one, that we are facing active governmental and state repression top down from a party that has a specific ideology that believes in a majoritarianism, no matter what it says abroad. And it results in changes in law. So we've had since 2014 changes in law, which for the first time have introduced a religious discrimination into citizenship, the CAA law. We've got triple talaq, which criminalizes divorce only for a particular part of the citizenry, which is Muslim men. We have reversed the burden of proof on several laws. including citizenship, including on triple talaq. It doesn't matter if an adult Indian woman marries into a family. It is not for her to show that she changed her faith of her own volition. It is for the family, the Muslim family, to prove to the satisfaction of the state that she did so. Beef possession, we have a reversal of burden of proof. There was a man convicted in Gujarat in 2019 for not being able to prove that the meat that he served at his daughter's wedding many days earlier was not beef. The life sentence for a possession of beef for cow slaughter in Gujarat is life, which is not a punishment that is given to any other economic crime. So these are the ways in which the state has sought to change the nature of the polity in our country, and to a large extent it has been successful. The changes in law have come. There has been very little resistance from the judiciary. There is almost no opposition politically to what is happening in terms of the changes in law. The resistance has come primarily from civil society, and which is why it is the case that people that we are speaking about today are in jail, that they are the ones who are standing up for what is happening to our society today, what is happening to 1.3 billion people as a whole. But the spots of specific resistance are not many. The mass resistance spaces are there. I would say that one reason why the citizenship law, which discriminates specifically against Muslims, was passed but has not been implemented yet, was the very brave resistance of Muslims, especially women, and to a smaller extent, a part of civil society and students. And I think to a large extent, why the farm laws, though they've been passed, have not been actually implemented, is the very brave resistance on the street of the farmers who are outside Delhi as we speak. The only reason why I believe that the Bhima Koregaon 16 are in jail is that they speak for those who are being oppressed at this time. The brutalization of the state that is actively deployed under the BJP and Mr. Modi is being resisted by a few, including these 16. I think that the state intends to go through the motions of the trial. I don't think anybody in their senses would believe that this is going towards conviction. The fact that external agents have shown, especially in Rona Wilson's case, that this is malicious and this is intentional, that not only have you fragmented the case into three parts. One is the violence that comes out of the January incident in which none of these 16 are part of. Secondly, the absurd charge that there is a conspiracy to overthrow the government. The third is, I think it's laughable that there is a sort of plot to assassinate Mr. Modi. The charge sheet itself, which is more than 5,000 pages long, devotes 10 pages to this nonsense. I don't think the state seriously takes the charge sheet itself. That is not the point. The point is entirely to make sure that those who stand up and stand for and resist what the state is doing, to resist in any form what is being done to the minorities of this country and the marginalized of this country, they should be tested so hard that the rest of us do not stand up. I think we can also draw a parallel to the to what has happened in this week in the Supreme Court. Delhi High Court passed a judgment which tears to shreds, rightfully so, what UAPA intends to do with the pogrom in Delhi. The Supreme Court shamefully, I should say, and I think unlawfully, says that this cannot be used as a precedent. On what basis, we don't know. Purely on the basis of the fact that the state doesn't want it to be a precedent. If we were to look coldly at the facts of the case, neither in the Delhi pogrom and the violence against the Muslims there, the violence instigated primarily by the BJP and its agents, one should say here, as has been established, or in the case of the Bhima Koregaon 16, there is absolutely nothing in the charge sheets to show that they should be in jail. The fact that they remain in jail today is entirely due to the fact that the state looks on them with malice. The state looks on them as examples and doesn't want them to become the sort of heroes and heroines that they actually are. My last point is to dwell on what it is that the rest of us can do. I think that as we have seen, external pressure helps make the state of India behave in a way that it should. The reason why CA is not yet implemented, a discriminatory law, the reason why the farm laws have not yet been implemented is to a large extent because of a pressure on the state. The laws are already on the book. Jammu and Kashmir did not have internet for 17 months. Jammu and Kashmir's children were denied education throughout the pandemic. It was only lifted a few days after the Biden administration took office. And one reason for that is that the U.S. House of Congress had a motion which was tabled, which Mr. Jaishankar ran away from, which said, condemned India for its behavior. I think we should ask India's friends abroad. There was something that Mr. Modi signed this week called the Open Society Statement with the rest of the G7, where he said that human rights would be a fundamental principle that India would not only follow, but it would promote. I think that we should welcome this statement. We should hold India and the government to this statement, and we should ask India's friends abroad to make sure that India follows this. Not only generally speaking on issues of civil liberties, but specifically speaking on cases that have become emblematic, in particular the people who've been jailed unjustly in the Delhi pogroms and on the Bhima Koregaon 16 case. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Agar, once again for your valuable opinion, which helped to understand the nuances in this case. Now it's open for discussion. I would like to invite audience to raise your questions.
Thank you, Simi. I can see that time-wise, we are nearly there at 1.5 hours, but lots of you are still there. And if it's okay with the panel members, we can continue for a little while more and take, because we do have quite a few questions actually for you. So thank you. And Shahrukh, I'd like to start with you. There were two questions I think that we could you could possibly take together. There's a question by Meena Dhanda. Thank you for the excellent talk. Is there a point in blaming the colonial legacy for horrendous Indian laws decades after independence? Especially as the comparison is being made with laws relating to detention in Scotland and England, which reportedly incorporate the duty of care. What is the reason the black letter of the law in India has failed to align with standards of common law? And the second question by Lekhpal is that in the case of no evidence being found against the accused and they are released without conviction, what action, if any, is taken against the prosecuting authorities, especially in the case of authorities acting on behalf of political actors? What recourse to compensation do the victims have in law?
Yeah, found it. Yeah. The first question is, why should we blame colonial legacies for the problems in our penal laws and procedural laws? I think the comparison with Scotland and England and Wales as well proves that point. Ireland is still very different, I'm told. That what the kind of laws that they implemented in the colonies was displayed a very, very different kind of power dynamic and relationship between the state and the subject. So therefore, if you look at bureaucracy in India, if you look at police in India, the kind of relationship it has with the subject is very different from the one that it has in the UK itself. In the UK, for instance, abolition of policing or defunding the policing are political discourses, they're part of political narratives. In India, I heard about abolition recently, and I thought the person was talking about abolition of alcohol, which is how we understand it in India. Even I hadn't heard of this at all, ever. So my reference to colonial legacy was more in the sense of the structural institutional relationship, the power dynamic between the state and the subject. But the second part of the question, why have we not changed it? And for that, yes, we are solely responsible. There have been many, many amendments where we wanted them, particularly in commercial laws, in arbitration, in civil laws, but not so many in criminal laws, or at least not so many in this part of criminal law, which strengthens the nation state, the post-colonial nation state also. So that process has continued, and I think that even the post-colonial states carry on the structural violence of being the erstwhile colonies. That was the first question. The second question was to do with malicious prosecution and what happens after. So again, two things. One, the accused, like Jenny was also pointing out, are always from very marginalized communities. And this whole process of incarceration is extremely resource intensive, both in terms of finances, also in terms of manpower. Entire families sort of spend their lives trying to get the incarcerated person out. So by the time that person actually comes out after a decade or two decades, nobody has the energy or the resources to again go back to court and ask for a compensation or ask for some kind of prosecution of the offending officers. And also jurisprudence in that regard in India is not developed at all. We have tried going to court for malicious prosecution, but somehow there's not enough material yet. Compensations are also few and far between, and more tokenism than actually sort of, you know, anything worthwhile. So that is also an area of jurisprudence that needs to be developed in India.
Thank you, Shahrukh. Simi, I'll hand over to you to ask the next couple of questions to Akar, after which I'd like, anyone from the family members also, if you want to comment on either of the questions we would have asked by then to Shahrukh and Akar. So over to you, Simi.
There is a question to Akar. Can you offer a view on who is actively sanctioning this act? And are these sanctioned as guidelines, or are these reviewed as individual incidents? Let me look at your job list as so and so being arrested. In other words, can you give us a view of machinery that implements these acts? The implementers mostly are people with families and who are live regular lives. Why do they take part in acts that go against common sense?
I think this is a sort of Hannah Arendt question. I think in our part of the world, the institution is malleable. It is soft. And I think when you have a strong leadership that takes charge, it tends to bend to its will. And I'm not talking just about the police state. I also mean the judiciary, which is malleable in our part, and the of institutional framework, including the IFS and the IAS, both which are seen as being high quality, generally speaking, but are actually quite low quality in the sense that do not have independence and will do whatever it is that is told to them. Even in a space where intellectually the control of Delhi is at a low level, but it's strong, as is the case under Mr. Modi, the system will tend to be pliant. I think that the police, we should ask ourselves why it is that weeks after Mr. Thackeray takes over the state of Maharashtra, the NIA is given the charge of the Bhima Koregaon case. And the reason is that the NIA, like the CBI, is a handmaiden and will be okay with doing whatever it is that Mr. Shah says. The police in Maharashtra, which has been transferred to another political authority, which is the Shiv Sena and the Congress, and the NCP is no longer to be trusted. So we should be aware of the fact that the system, while it tends to be seen as functional, is quite open to being used by political actors at all levels. I would say that at the IFS and the IAS level, the IPS level definitely, and the judiciary as well. So that is what we are faced with, unfortunately.
There is another question to Shahrukh. The observation of SC on the Delhi High Court judgment is deeply disturbing. The Apex Court says Delhi High Court has turned the UPA on its head. This doesn't seem to bode well.
Sure.
Well, for either the BK16 or those accused in the CAA protest or anyone accused on the UAPA. Can we be hopeful after this?
No, I agree. It doesn't bode well at all. But this particular thing that the UAPA has been turned on its head was not the court's observation. It was an observation by the Solicitor General, amongst many others. He also said that the Constitution has been turned on its head. But another interesting, or odd, actually not interesting, reference that he made, which was casual, it was not part of formal arguments, was that he kept referring to some metaphorical bomb, because you need a bomb under Section 15. So he kept talking about a bomb. And then the other side said, what bomb are you talking about? And then he said, you know, the lady who killed the former prime minister, which is completely unconnected, but the SG does make statements. The interesting thing here is that particular reference where he's trying to make some connection between a very violent assassination of a former prime minister and the anti-CAA protests is actually very interesting, because the state versus Nalini. Nalini was one of the people who was accused in Rajiv Gandhi's assassination case, was actually one of the very few cases where the Supreme Court had held that just because it's political violence, it does not become terrorist violence. And the Supreme Court had said that even political violence can be covered by the ordinary Indian Penal Code. But terrorism is something more than that. Terrorism is a political label. So it's an interesting case to refer to, because it actually goes against what he's suggesting. The Supreme Court very categorically said that even though she killed the prime minister or assisted or conspired to assassinate the prime minister, it was not a terrorist act. It was a political act. But having said that, the admission of the appeal, the admission of the challenge by the Supreme Court is still very disheartening, because it's a very good judgment and now it's been put on hold. It cannot be used.
Thank you, Sharu. I hand over to Lodhia to ask the questions, remaining questions in from audience.
Thank you, Simi. I'm going to ask Yasagar, Koyal, Jenny, Father Xavier, if you have any comments that you want to respond on till now. But I'd also like to add one question from the questions to you here, which is from Khalid Akhtar. How responsible would you hold the judiciary for human rights abuse? You know, the Tuticorin case was mentioned by Shahrukh, and then, so I'm not going to repeat it again. But there's the Siddiqui Kapan case, where the journalist who is also in prison under similarly absurd charges, that the Chief Justice of India expressed his reluctance to entertain his habeas corpus petition, but that same Chief Justice issued notice for Mirzapur web series in Article 32 petition. And there's comparison where Justice Muralidhar asked the state to comply the Lalita Kumari judgment for lodging the FIR, the first information report, instantly, but the judge was transferred, and the Chief Justice of Delhi High Court gave the state free hand to lodge whenever whenever they want. Can we say yet that the judiciary is safe? And then we of course have the issue of the straw to stand Swami taking months to come and to be given, and the there is also the removal of Gautam Navlakha from Delhi to preempt his bail application. So Sagar, are you raising your hand?
No, I wasn't, but I mean, if anyone, does anyone else want to say?
I'd like to say that I have full faith in the judiciary of this country, but only because I don't have another option. If I had another option, I might not have that faith. We are told that on sufferance, we have to believe that the judiciary is right. On any kind of evidence, this would prove to be false.
Yeah, I think continuing with what Akar said, it's like being stuck between a rock and a hard place where you, like, you have to keep going to the judiciary again and again, because ultimately they are the only people who can provide relief, in spite of the fact that they failed us at multiple times and at multiple levels. Like Varvara Rao, and my mother is a lawyer, so I see a lot of the discussions that happen among the legal teams. In Varvara Rao's case in specifically, twice they went to the first the Sessions Court and then the Bombay High Court, saying that there is a pandemic. He is above 80. He is susceptible to catching COVID. Hence, he's liable. He should get bail because there's a high power commission. You've already spoken about decongesting prisons, and he should be given bail. Both times, in both courts, the bail was rejected on the grounds that he's already applied for bail before, and because of UAPA and section so-and-so in UAPA, he cannot be granted bail. And there was one particular line which was very infuriating to read, which says there's no change in circumstance from when he applied before and when he applied now. So to me and to anyone reading that line, it was preposterous, because the bail was only being applied on the grounds that is there's a massive change in circumstance where there is a pandemic, and hence he should be given bail considering the situation. So both times bail got rejected, and then ultimately you saw what happened, that he was on his deathbed. He literally, like, he was so close to dying. Like, my father was taking care of him personally for a month in the jail prison. And then when there was so much uproar, and there was internationally and nationally, there was so much uproar, then only did ultimately the court is the body that gave him relief and granted him bail. So ultimately, even though the judiciary failed him beforehand, and that failure led to his condition that he was in, they were the ultimate body that provided him relief. So they are currently the only body that we can go to. We really don't expect much from the state, and they're just so heavy-handed in their approach. They show no signs of backing down. So what we want is, what we require is for the judiciary to behave, to do their job, to do their role, to act as an independent body. This is something very basic aspect of political science that you learn in college, where you hear of separation of powers, where a judiciary and an executive have to function separately. In UAPA, what you just see is the judiciary parroting what the executive is saying, on the ground that they're not even saying that these charges could be true. They're just saying that prima facie there seems to be a case, and hence bail cannot be granted. So what is required, I feel, is that the pressure has to be maintained, because even in Varvara Rao's case, there was substantial pressure which ultimately got him shifted to a hospital and then ultimately gave him bail. So that pressure has to be kept on the court, and there is this sense that courts, the judiciary, is like a holier than thou institution because it's above things. And personally, I believe anybody is not above criticism. You have to assess them on the role they play, whether they're doing their jobs or not. You can't just assume that because it's a judiciary, everything they're saying is true. You have to check and see and ask them to be accountable, hold them accountable as well. As you hold a government accountable, you have to hold the judiciary accountable for them to do their jobs. And this whole thing of just rejecting bail outright, as you see in UAPA, in the Bhima Koregaon case, and in so many other cases that Jenny also was speaking about, that really has to be thought of again, where you have to go into the details of the case as happened in the Delhi, as the Delhi High Court judgment said, where you go into the specifics of a case and then make a decision. Don't just blanketly say that prima facie there seems to be a case. So yeah, it's a difficult situation. We really are stuck between a rock and a hard place, but we have to appeal to the courts. They are the only body that can provide relief.
Thank you, Sagar. Before I ask one of you to come in again, I just want to mention, because some people may be leaving, that, you know, keeping up the idea that we have to keep maintaining the pressure and what Akar said about pressure from outside. I just want to mention that on that India Civil Watch International and Asins of India had also on 10th of June sent a public appeal statement to all the relevant authorities to show compassion and responsibility and release all arrested human rights defenders into safe conditions. And this statement has been signed by over 50 international figures, including a former president of the United Nations Working Group on Arbitrary Detention, two Nobel laureates, a former Archbishop of Canterbury, and numerous prominent lawyers and members of parliament from Germany, from UK, from Spain, from Ireland and Switzerland, as well as international professional and civil society organizations. Now, many news outlets in India did publish this our press release or the appeal in full, but we have struggled to get it out in the international press. And we need help here. And if there's anybody who can help us here, please do let us know. We are going to continue to gather signatures on it. It is there on our website. And if you can help, please do email us at insafindia@protonmail.com and also sign our open letter, which is already been signed by 1,200 people. And we want to then eventually, obviously, get that out in the press as well. So thank you so much for that. So now, Koyal, Jenny, Father Xavier. Koyal, would you like to come in?
No, I think Sagar has covered quite a bit. Oh. There's anything else? I mean, if there are any other questions, last anything?
I think at the moment, then the questions are for Shahrukh and Akar, and then if you can come back and comment.
Sure.
We'll do that. So, Father Xavier, Jenny, would you like to add anything at this time? Yeah, Jenny, you've unmuted yourself.
Actually, I wanted to say one thing. Somebody had asked about compensation. And I was also talking about that in continuation. I wanted to say there was a very famous case.
Can you speak a bit louder? Sorry, Jenny, we can't hear you.
A very famous case in Kerala where an ISRO scientist was trapped in a fabricated spy case. And he was even a scientist, and he was given 1 point. So the fact why there is no compensation and accountability is, again, I want to go back and reiterate, is because of the kind of because it's the marginalized who are being incarcerated. And even in this case, the people who work for the marginalized, and many of them are also from the marginalized community, who are being incarcerated. When the right people get incarcerated, they will get compensation. We have to see that. And secondly, I want to say about, colonial law, when we talk about colonial laws being followed, when the call, again, this was brought up by a question, somebody asked a question about this. Colonies have moved on. They have changed the laws. So we have to not blame the colonial laws. We have to say, why didn't we do that? What has stopped us from reforming as a society? And what are the kinds of reforms that we have? What is stopping us? Why are we stuck with colonial law? Who's stopping each of these policies? Who is responsible for that? We need to talk more about that. We have to talk about colonial law. When the colonies have moved on and so much, have adopted so much, given so much importance to human life, why are we not?
Yeah, I think Jenny's connection. Jenny, your connection wasn't very clear. Could you repeat the last bit?
Case, without going into the problems of the judiciary, again, this is extremely problematic. Without going into that, I just want to say one thing. UAPA is playing a very major role, and at this moment the nation is debating about UAPA, and we need to bring that into focus. And especially the Vatali, Zahoor Vatali judgment, it's literally, I am not a legal expert, but what I understand from what the legal experts have told me, literally is like police comes and tells the court to need some evidence, and the court says that we will we'll just go by this evidence that you have brought up, because you say that these people are terrorists, dreaded people who are working against the nation, and then we will examine it. And when will you examine it? After 10 years or 20 years, and you will examine and find that the evidence is faulty. So this is the situation. This is created by UAPA, and it's a horrible law. And the reason why in all the cases that where political prisoners are there, they are still in jail, not only because the judicial system is bad, it is bad, but also because of UAPA. And if we want these people out, we also have to raise our voices against UAPA, which goes against international conventions also, and which is this best way to put people inside without any evidence. For example, in the Delhi, the NRCC, the Devangana, Asif Khanna, all these people, the only thing the police has to tell the court is that they have conducted a protest. The court doesn't have to do anything else. Just go by that and put them, throw them in jail. They have spent 1 year in jail. Students have spent 1 year in jail. This is UAPA. So we need to think more about that.
Thank you, Jenny. Father Xavier?
I just want to say two things. For me, we know these 16% are a message more than a BK16 case. It's a message that really brings out the larger concerns in a platform like this. There are very many more people who are worse affected than this street. Also, their voices have not come out. So the challenge is, how do we use this narrative into education of the masses, the academicians, the judges, and every one of them, so that there is a new discourse that comes. That's a right tribute to these 16%, I feel. And I also go with what has been said by Akar and Sagar. We have no way. Because in this totalitarian fascist regime, every institution has been collapsed, destroyed, and they have been all forced to toe the line of the majoritarian politics. There seems to be some hopes, and it's high time the judiciary rescues itself. If it cannot rescue itself, I don't think anybody can rescue, because that's the independence of the judiciary that's given by the Constitution. This is nobody's property. If any attempt to be made to toe the line of the majority in politics, it is the responsibility of every organ, whether it's a media, it's a bureaucracy, it's judiciary. Nobody else can do it. The civil society can play its role, but every institution also has to look at its role and play their part.
Thank you, Father Xavier. We are now 20 minutes over, but we have still got a lot of you there. And yeah, Shahrukh, I'm actually coming to you. So what I thought was, we can do one more round of questions with Shahrukh and Akar, and then we can end with comments with the family members. So Shahrukh, if you don't mind, I can give you those two questions, and then you can come in together. So there's Salman Qureshi, who asked whether we all agree that the underlying culprits are the colonial laws like sedition law and the legal process that allows misuse of UAPA laws. Are there any efforts to push political parties towards changing these and initiating police reforms and not use these laws and processes opportunistically whenever they are in power? So Jenny obviously has just talked about this as well. And one by an anonymous attendee who says, how do we not exceptionalize the BK16 case since it involves middle class academics and activists, people like us, but constantly keep in the foreground, as Jenny has said, all the other under trials and incarcerated in our prisons for whom we don't hold such webinars?
Sure. I actually wanted to clarify with both Jenny and Meena, who'd asked that question earlier, that I'm not suggesting that we are stuck in our colonial past without agency and we're stuck with what we have. I was suggesting that it suits us to continue with what we have, which is a very peculiar relationship of power between the state and the subject. And that also sort of flows into Salman's question about why things are not changing. In fact, the state is bringing in new law, new security legislation, which builds upon everything that's outrageous about the sedition laws. So we're actually moving towards less civil liberties and more powerful ideas of sort of more powerful dismissal of any kind of dissent. So Salman, there are efforts. We do talk about how sedition laws should be done away with. But I think for the moment, like Akar was saying, that the state is so strong and all encompassing and all pervasive that movement has not been very successful. And the second question, I think, is something for civil society to think about generally. As lawyers, we actually deal a lot more with all the other cases in a day's work. There are all kinds of people that we take to court. But for civil society together, how do we foreground some? What should the strategies be? Thank you.
Oh, thank you, Shahrukh. I suppose then, yeah, that question might extend to you, Akar, as well. But there are just two more. I think the two more questions, which I think can be together, and if you can then comment on all of them. So the first question from Sangeeta Kamar: do you see political leaders and human rights organizations in Europe and elsewhere paying attention to the BK16 case? Are they recognizing that human rights and democracy in India are seriously under attack from within, and recognizing the grave situation? And actually linked to this possibly is Leila Kadikwal's question about, could you possibly speak of how the USA, the UK and Israel are involved in India, if possible? I mean, maybe the one feeds into the other.
So I'll go first back to the second question that Shahrukh Alam responded to. I think every movement has its mandalas. It has its emblematic figures. And for many of us, maybe not for all of us, I think the BK16 and those who have been arrested in the Delhi pogrom represent what it is that this government has done to the citizenry. And while it is nobody's case that these are the only people who are being oppressed in our country, I think it is important for us to highlight the specific stories of some, so that the world may come to know what is happening in India of 2021. To the first question, I think the colonial laws are softer than what we are facing today. 101 years ago, people were gathered in Amritsar and were willing to be shot. Many of them were killed at Jallianwala Bagh, opposing a preventive detention. That is what the Rowlatt Act was. It was an act which gave the state the permission to lock up Indians without charge or trial. Today, every state in India has got 2, 3, 4 laws that let the government of the state and the center do exactly that. We are letting the government of India, democratically elected, do to us what we did not let the Raj do to us. And I think that the citizenry must know that this is what it has come to. In 2021, we are not part of the liberal democratic space that Western Europe represents and what the G7 declaration represents. We are a sort of colonial state, in many ways even more regressive. I think that it would have been hard for a colonial state to have gone and done what has been done to us in the last 7 years and not face any accusations of injustice. Today, to stand up for those who are oppressed is to face jail yourself. I think that fact should be recognized. I think to turn to the last question, what is it that the West can do? I think the advantage that we have is that, unlike China, we are still a constitutionally democratic space, that we believe and we pretend to be, in many ways, operating under a secular kind of Nehruvian carapace when we engage with the rest of the world. When Mr. Modi goes to the G7, he doesn't say that I am a Hindutva state which doesn't want Muslims from Pakistan and Bangladesh and Afghanistan, and I don't want the refugees. What he says is that we are a civilizational state which is open, Vasudeva Kutumbakam, Atiti Deva Bhava. That is the kind of nonsense that we spout when we engage with the external world. That should be used, I think. I think we should ask our friends in the EU, in the US, in Africa, in the rest of the world, which believe in a particular India, which many of us also believe in, to impress upon the government of India and the state that it should behave according to its own constitutional values. We're not asking for anything different. We are only asking that the people in within this space be treated in the framework of law of the same sort that the constitutional promises that it will with the people of India. And I think there is nothing wrong, A, with either asking the rest of the world to aggressively engage with India and with the Modi government and push back against things that are seen as being wrong, as is the case with CA, as is the case with a lot of the laws. B, there is nothing wrong with asking the rest of the world to ask India whether it actually believes and implements in the formulations and things that it itself says, as it did in the Open Society's declaration last week. Thank you.
Thank you, Akar. There is one last question left. Is there any hope which possibly, yes, Shahrukh, if you would like to quickly, if you could give us a couple of sentences and then I'll ask the family members to give closing comments. Is there any hope for the rest of the jailed human rights activists given the recent release of Kalita and Natasha?
Yes, we can't lose hope. We certainly can't lose hope. But technically speaking, the very well-reasoned judgment of the Delhi High Court that had actually laid down law on bail jurisprudence under UAPA has now been frozen, but the Supreme Court has said that it can't be used as a precedent. But that still means that the findings of the High Court can't be used. The arguments that have been deployed to arrive at the finding can still be used by lawyers across the country and by brave courts across the country. But we need those brave courts. Thank you.
Thank you so much. So I'll come back to Sagar. Would you like to say anything as we end the session?
Can I go next after someone? I'm still gathering my thoughts.
Yeah.
Sorry, Father Xavier, okay. Would you like to start?
I just want to say one sentence. Yes, Stan and the other BK16 narrative is painful, but at least for me personally, not disheartened, still hopeful.
Thank you, Father. Koyal, I
just wanted to say that I think we need to have more such events, more spaces like these to have many more discussions around this and create as much awareness as possible, especially in the international circles. And this has to go out as much as possible. And we need to keep building pressure. So yeah, that's what I feel. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Koyal. Jenny?
In the light of this judgment, I think there should be more discussion on UAPA. And I think there should be more research and more publicizing of who are what is happening with UAPA? How many people have been, how has it been used? Who has it been used against? How many years have they been in prison? And what was the rate of acquittal? Some of the facts have come out, but we need more human stories to come out. We need not just, when there is, after 9 years, somebody is acquitted, then you tell the story. But what about all the people who are still in jail just for making a phone call, just for giving your, lending your scooter? And we have to understand how UAPA has been used against the Muslim community also. That is very important. It's not only in this case, but in so many other cases. So many people are in jail using UAPA. And that discussion should start at least in the light of this judgment. We should have a very, very vibrant discussion about UAPA and how it has been used as a social tool to literally oppress minorities and the marginalized.
Thank you, Jenny. Sagar?
Yeah, I think connecting to what Koel said, that yeah, we have to maintain the pressure. Like actually what everyone was saying, we have to maintain the pressure, and in light of this judgment, we have to sell it. It was a victory. In fact, to see those girls and to see Asif come out, and those, it was such a celebratory atmosphere, and you know, it was really something to celebrate that judgment. And the way it questioned UAPA, that is what is required. Like courts have to act in that independent manner, and civil society, us academics and everyone have to come together and really question these sort of unjust acts, which really derail and destroy people's lives for years on end, and then there's no compensation after that. Nothing. Their families are destroyed, their personal life, everything is just put on hold. And in what you're seeing in Bhima Koregaon, so many of them are in life-threatening situations. They're catching COVID, their eyesight might go. And so yeah, the pressure has to be maintained, and the discussion around UAPA has to continue, because the situation is still precarious with all of these Bhima Koregaon activists. They're still in very dangerous situation. And we don't need another case where somebody almost dies or loses. I mean, yeah, it shouldn't reach that point. It's a very painful place to be in, and it definitely shouldn't go to that place. So yeah, we should keep up the pressure. Thank you. Thank you very much for joining, for listening to us, and for having this plan.
No, thank you all for joining us. And share, it is painful, but thank you so much for all your comments and views. And I thank everyone in the audience, especially most of you, like I said, have stayed on till now. So thank you once again for being with us, and we will send you information about further, whatever we do further around this. So please share the information, pass on the emails to all your friends, and let's get the information about this out as far wide as we can. I have to confess myself, I came to know about all this fairly late myself. I did not hear about it in the places I was reading, or the people I knew were not talking about all this. So I'll end now, because it is very late. But thank you again to Akar, to Shahrukh, Father Xavier, Sagar, Jenny, Koel, to all of you for joining Simi and myself, and to ICWI International, Civil Watch International, for supporting us and co-hosting this with us, and to everyone in the audience for being with us and expressing your solidarity, and let's continue with it. So good night, good evening, or good morning, wherever you are. Stay safe and stay well, and we'll end here. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.